Hi, this is Annie Dance. Please subscribe to AnnieDance.substack.com, my Cops and Congress newsletter, where I work to shine a light on police and policy issues in Western North Carolina and beyond. Today, Wednesday, July 10th, 2024, the North Carolina Board of Transportation is about to meet. So just a note on my Substack, you can type in your email here, or you can become a paid subscriber to get access to more posts and scoops. So let's see what officials are saying today. They're having a virtual board meeting. And what's really interesting to me, I'm going to attempt to share this here while I navigate my accessibility keyboard because my keys stopped working. Some of my keys stopped working on my laptop here. But nevertheless, let's move forward and look at the July agenda. Obviously, you can do a keyword search and find what's important to you. The agenda is pretty bare bones for just what is going on. In the project list, which is currently accessible from this page here, go and you can do a keyword search. So, for example, in Rutherford County, there's a number of projects that are in the works that are on the STIP for consideration, including over $125 million. Has previously been approved for construction. Additional funds are requested. This is a cash flow project with $4.25 million in 2025 and $4.25 million in 2026. This is a build and see bond project. So more on that to come. And also Rutherfordton apparently is they're looking to purchase four electric vehicles at the request of the Office of Strategic Initiatives for $291,000. Very interesting. And then moving on, again, you'll see the full breakout of that pricing for Project R2233BA. US 221 north of US 74 bypass to south of US 74 business to allow additional time for planning and design, delay right-of-way acquisition from FY fiscal year 24 to fiscal year 25, and construction from fiscal year 27 to fiscal year 28. Very interesting. Again, that is over $125 million. I'm not, that's a huge, huge project. So more to come as more information is learned about that. But that struck me as, of course, very interesting to those who live, work, and drive through Rutherford County. So let's try to watch the meeting. They ho live stream it on Vimeo. When I looked last time, I didn't see a July link. I still don't see a July link. And the meeting was scheduled to begin at 9:30 this morning. So let me pause the screen sharing just a moment while I investigate where I could find it. Apparently on Vimeo, it's not up at the top for some reason. You have to go scroll down and load more and then keep scrolling, keep scrolling, keep scrolling, keep scrolling. Finally, you see browser test and July 2024. Not exactly most user-friendly, but here we go.
We are coming to the section of our agenda where we do our road, bridge, and ferry naming honorary designations, and we're blessed to have a number of very deserving people to honor today. These have all been through our road naming committee and been approved for recommendation to the full board for approval. Since we're having a virtual meeting and the law requires us to have a roll call vote for every vote we take, I would suggest, assuming that there's no objection from the rest of the board,
that we read all of the resolutions in order and then take one vote on all of the resolutions. Is there any, and then we can go back and have board members comment and family and friends comment after we approve all of them. Is there any objection from anyone on the board for that procedure? It'll save you from hearing me call your name 4 or 5 different times. So. All right, I see none for that. So our first one is the Coach George Williams Interchange, and that's in Division 5. So I would ask Board Member Jordan if she would read that designation for us. And you're on the mute, Valerie, I believe. Stacey, can you
I'm back. I'm sorry.
No,
thank
you're
you,
good.
Everyone. I apologize for that.
No, you're good. Thank you.
All right. I am going to read this morning the resolution for Coach George Williams for the interchange. Whereas in 44 years of coaching at St. Augustine's University, Coach George Williams and his Falcons and Lady Falcons track and field teams brought home 39 national titles in NAAC Division II. And whereas these titles place Coach Williams among the top coaches in track and field, and whereas Williams led the 2004 U.S. Olympic track and field team, assisted in the U.S. gold medal effort in 1996. And coached Olympic level athletes, and whereas Williams has been recognized with more than 150 coaching awards, including the NCAA Division II National Coach of the Year, a total of 20 times. And whereas the legacy of Coach Williams is seen in his student athletes who have excelled on the track or cross country course, earning 282 individual national crowns, while his scholarship students maintain a 95% graduation rate. And whereas the City of Raleigh Council requests the North Carolina Department of Transportation name an interchange in honor of Coach George Williams. Now, therefore, be it resolved, the North Carolina Board of Transportation names the interchange on Interstate 440 at New Bern Avenue in Raleigh the Coach George Williams Interchange. The appropriate signs will be erected at a suitable time, adopted this day, the 10th of July, 2004, by the North Carolina Board of Transportation. Signed, Michael S. Fox, Chairman, and J.R. Hopkins, Secretary of Transportation.
Thank you, Valerie. Our next resolution to be considered is the Senator Jim Hughes Bridge. If I could get Board Member Phillips to read that, please.
This is the resolution for the Senator Jim Hughes Bridge. Whereas James Hughes was born in Lumbel, North Carolina, and was a native of Avery County, and whereas Hughes was a veteran and served our country in World War II, and whereas Hughes represented the people of Avery County by serving in the North Carolina House and the North Carolina Senate, and whereas Hughes established and was the president of the Florence Boyd Home, which held summer camps for underprivileged children and assisted to those in need, and whereas Hughes was a charter member of the Pinola Moose Lodge, served as a certified emergency medical technician, was a member of the Limville Lodge number 489, and a Shriner. And whereas the Avery County Board of Commissioners requests the North Carolina Department of Transportation name a bridge in honor of Senator James Hughes. Now, therefore, be it resolved, the North Carolina Board of Transportation names the bridge crossing the Lumble River on Ruffin Street in Avery County, the Senator Jim Hughes Bridge, that appropriate shrines will be erected at a suitable time, adopted this, the 10th day of July, 2024, by the North Carolina Board of Transportation, Chairman Michael S. Fox, Secretary of Transportation J.R. Hopkins.
Thank you. I believe you also have the next one, Megan, the Patrolman John W. Wallen Bridge. Would you read that one, please?
Absolutely. This is the resolution for Patrolman John William Wallen Bridge. Whereas John William Wallen was born in Madison County in October 1941 and was a lifelong North Carolina resident. And whereas Wallen was stationed in Caldwell and Avery counties and served those citizens with distinction. And whereas the citizens of Caldwell and Avery counties and the state of North Carolina are grateful for individuals who are willing to make the ultimate sacrifice to protect their family, friends, and neighbors. And whereas Wallen made this sacrifice and was killed when his patrol car left the roadway and struck a tree during the pursuit on April 1st, 1966 in Avery County. And whereas the North Carolina State Highway Patrol wishes to honor Patrolman Wallen for his distinguished public service to the state of North Carolina. And whereas the North Carolina State Highway Patrol requests the North Carolina Department of Transportation name a bridge in honor of Patrolman Wallen. Now, therefore, be it resolved, the North Carolina Board of Transportation names the bridge crossing the Lumble River on US 221 near Ruffin Street, the Patrolman John W. Wallen Bridge, that appropriate signs will be erected at a suitable time, adopted this the 10th day of July, 2024, by the North Carolina Board of Transportation, Chairman Michael S. Fox, Secretary of Transportation J.R. Hopkins.
Thank you. I believe the next one is the Trooper Brandon C. Peterson Bridge. If I could get Board Member Clark to read that one, please.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. This is the resolution for the Master Trooper Brandon C. Peterson Bridge. Whereas Brandon Carroll Peterson was born in Mitchell County in March 1986, and was a lifelong North Carolina resident. And whereas Peterson served a distinguished career as a law enforcement officer with the North Carolina State Highway Patrol for 9 years, and whereas as a master trooper, Peterson was a field training officer and received the Mother Against Drunk Driving Award for his diligence in impaired driving enforcement, and whereas Peterson was also very active in his community and a devoted member of Bethel Baptist Church, and whereas Peterson suffered a fatal heart attack in the line of duty and died in April 2017, and whereas the North Carolina State Highway Patrol wishes to honor Master Trooper Peterson for his distinguished public service to the state of North Carolina, and whereas the North Carolina State Highway Patrol requests that the NC Department of Transportation name a bridge in honor of Master Trooper Peterson, now therefore be it resolved, the North Carolina Board of Transportation names bridge on US 19 at the Yancey-Mitchell County line, the Master Trooper Brandon Peterson Bridge, that appropriate signs will be erected at a suitable time, adopted this the 10th day of July, 2024, by the North Carolina Board of Transportation.
Thank you, Billy. All right, so we have a motion by Valerie for the Coach George Williams Interchange, a motion by Megan for the Senator Jim Hughes Bridge, another motion by Megan for the Patrolman John W. Wallen Bridge, and a motion by Billy for Trooper Brandon C. Peterson Bridge. Would it be possible to get one person to second all of those?
Second the motion, Mr. Chairman.
All right, thanks. Those are all seconded by Vice Chairman Perkins. Is there any discussion on any of these items? Hearing none, I'll do a roll call. I vote yes. Andy Perkins?
Yes.
Alan Moran?
Yes.
Joe Alcock?
Yes.
Landon Zimmer?
Yes.
Melvin Mitchell?
Yes.
Leo Daughtry?
Yes.
Valerie Jordan?
Yes.
Brady Hunt? know Grady is with us. He texted me, but we're having trouble getting his audio. Lisa Mathis?
Yes.
Pat Malamphy?
Yes.
Steven Rosenborough?
Yes.
Tony Lathrop?
Yes.
Megan Phillips?
Yes.
Brad Lael?
Yes.
Kathy Harrington? Billy Clark?
Yes.
Dirk Cody?
Yes.
And Chuck McGrady?
Yes.
All right, those pass unanimously. So let's go back in the order that we took these and have folks who would like to say something about these worthy designees have the opportunity to do that. I believe for the Coach George Williams Interchange, we have four speakers. Our good friend, Senator Dan Blue, is here. We have Coach George Williams as well. Council Member Corey Branch from the City of Raleigh and Averett Ward, former president of St. Augustine's University from 2014 to 2019. So if you, unless there's some objection, we'll just take them in that order. Senator Blue.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and good morning to all of the board members. First, I was just thinking the Olympics start in a couple of weeks. And it is so appropriate that here 2 weeks, a little more than 2 weeks from the beginning of the Olympics in Paris, we're able to celebrate one of the most celebrated, but more importantly, one of the most successful coaches in Olympic history, and especially in track and field. You look at the meaning of the term coach, all of us know it, but it instructs or trains a performer, a team. Well, George, we call him Pup. Williams is a coach in all sense of the word. But not only coaches and trains people regarding team, but trains people and coaches them on what life is. If you look at the success of his students who run in his track and field programs over that 44-year period that he's actively coached, you see them playing significant roles as leaders in their countries. Because many of these kids came from outside the United States. Tremendous number did come, but people used to flock and still do to the triangle here from all over the world to have the coach train them on techniques. I feel fortunate having been the coach's friend probably 50 years, but more importantly, watching him hand in hand, watching him recruit kids down in the Caribbean, going with him, and where they considered him a demigod of sorts, watching him take the time just to stop and watch high school kids, middle school kids, just riding by school, giving them some pointers on how to be more effective in running. My son ran on some championship teams at Duke, and coach would take time when he was in middle school and high school just to give him pointers without him asking anything. So I think that it is appropriate to recognize that a fellow in the triangle, trained in the tradition of two other great coaches who were here and were celebrated at the Olympic level, Leroy Walker and Al Buehler. But it's appropriate that as we look at Coach Williams, he could have gone anywhere in the country, but he chose to stay at his alma mater, which is a signal of loyalty and a willingness to hang in and make things so much better. I'm honored to have joined in this effort to get this interchange on Newman Avenue named for Coach Williams. He traveled that road about every day for probably about 45 or 50 years, or maybe even more when he was a student. And so many people will be reminded of all the tremendous contributions he has made, the leadership he has provided as a come off of the Beltline on the Newman Avenue. And so I thank all of you on the board for recognizing Coach Williams and joining in the many folk who honored and recognized him, but most importantly, making sure that folk in this region where he lives understands the significant contributions that he's made all over this world. Thanks again.
Thank Thank you, Senator, and thank you for being here this morning and also for your long and distinguished service to our state as well.
Thank you.
Coach Williams? Can we check and see if perhaps he's muted and needs some help getting unmuted? We can always come back to him as well if we need to.
Chairman, we don't see him online on Teams.
Okay. Well, maybe he will join us. We'll move next to Council Member Corey Branch.
Hey, good morning. Thank you for having me.
Good morning.
Excuse me, there's some background noise. I'm actually at a groundbreaking that COPS is having here in Raleigh for more houses. But today's a great day, I think. Coach Williams, I've lived up to him in my number of years being a Raleigh native, and just the work he's done of being a mentor, being a role model to our young people and to our college students at St. Augustine's University. But also introducing, you know, track and field as a way of education, getting an education and using it as a tool in the vehicle has just been something that's been tremendous. And I'm proud that the city unanimously endorsed and supported this recognition and naming of this interchange. And I just want to thank the state, and I want to thank Member Valerie Jordan for her hard work, Senator Blue, Mr. Fred Aiken, and others that played a vital part in making sure that we uphold people and give them the roses while they're here. And definitely want to thank the state and all of you, all board members, for your unanimous support, and look forward to the day that we can do the unveiling of the flag. So again, I don't want to hold you all long. I know you have a long agenda, but just the city of Raleigh is grateful for Coach Williams, and we're grateful for all the work that takes place here. And thank you for having me.
Council member, and thank you for your service as well. President Ward?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, Fox, and members of the Board of Transportation, it's an honor to be with you this morning. And I want to thank you for your unwavering support of recognizing Coach Williams for his years of dedicated service to North Carolina, the citizens of North Carolina. As a graduate of St. Augustine's and also having the privilege of having served as president of the university, while I also want to join in the celebratory remarks regarding Coach Williams' notable international reputation as an Olympic coach, I want you to also understand him as an educator. Very few people know Coach Williams began here in North Carolina as a public school teacher and was a distinguished public school teacher, and then came to St. Augustine's. And for 45 plus years, also having served as a student for over 50 plus years, has dedicated his life to higher education. As a graduate of Wake Forest University with a Master's of Business Administration, he was a distinguished professor, and as many of us called him, a life coach for students, not only from an academic perspective, but from a life learning perspective of being contributors to society. Coach Williams is a distinguished individual who has an unwavering commitment to public service and to higher education. And I join my colleagues here today. I want to thank each of you, especially Board Member Valerie Jordan, for this honor for Coach Williams. And thank you again, and I look forward to the day that we will have the naming of this for you.
Thank you, President. Did we manage to see if Coach Williams was able to join? Okay, great. Well, if he happens to join, let me know and we'll come back to it. All right, we'll move on to speakers for the Senator Jim Hughes Bridge.
Hi, my name is Crystal. My name is Crystal Harrell. I'm Coach George Williams' daughter. I'm on the other line trying to get him on. I don't know if he has the latest email invite, so I was just trying to get that over to him. So we are working very hard to get him on. Hopefully by the time you finish the other resolutions, he'll be on.
Of course. I apologize
for the interruption. Okay,
thank you for sharing that with us. We would love to hear from the coach. So when he is able to get on, we'll definitely look forward to hearing from his comments. Ari, I don't believe we have anyone that is speaking for the Senator Jim Hughes Bridge. Is that correct?
Yeah.
All right. Let's move to the Patrolman John W. Wallen Bridge, and we have a number of folks here. We have Sheila Wallen, who is Patrolman Wallen's youngest sister, and we have a number of folks from the Highway Patrol, Captain Randy Deaton, Lieutenant Joshua Dowdle, First Sergeant Cody Smith, and Don Stamey, as well as Colonel Freddie Johnson is here as well. So I think we'll start, if we could, with Ms. Wallen, if you'd like to share some remarks with us, and then we'll give the Highway Patrol an opportunity to say anything they'd like to say. Ms. Wallen, I think you're on mute somehow, because I can see you talking, but I can't hear you. Apologize. It looks like you're unmuted, but I still can't hear you. Are we having the same issue in the boardroom? All right. Well, maybe let's work on seeing if we can get her audio, and then while we're doing that, I will move to any of the members of the patrol that would like to say anything. Good morning, Colonel.
Good morning, Chairman Fox and the board. I just want to thank you on behalf of the family of Trooper Wallen and the greater Highway Patrol. I want to thank everyone on this board that made this happen and helped us, go back and honor Trooper Wallen. I could tell you that he is very worthy of this honor in light of the sacrifice that him and his family made. I've talked about this before with several of you. The Highway Patrol is a partner to DOT, and we work together very closely. And the patrol was actually created as a part of the Division of Highways to protect the highway infrastructure for this state. And that's exactly what Patrolman Wallen was doing when he made the ultimate sacrifice. And we are very grateful that that the board has helped us go back in time and get this honor secured for him and his family. And we look forward to getting this bridge, officially named, and his family can see that. I just an FYI for the group, if you've never heard us talk about this, we've got Patrolman Wallen, and we're honoring Trooper Peters. If you don't know the difference between what those titles mean, Patrolman, when the patrol was created in 1929, that was the designation for modern day troopers. And in 1979, we got the first female on the highway patrol, and it was converted to the term trooper. So that's the difference in patrolman and trooper. But Chairman Fox, and again, all the members of the DOT board, thank you for helping us get this done. And we look forward to celebrating with the family on the day we actually go out there and put that sign up at that bridge. Thank you to everyone.
Thank you, Colonel. Have we got some audio for Ms. Wallen yet?
Not yet. We're still working on it, sir.
Perhaps if you don't mind, Aria or Shelley, just contact her directly, and perhaps she can call in. That may be a good solution. We'll pause for just a minute and see if we can get that going.
Also resent the invite to Coach Williams to see if he can log on.
Great, thank you. we're blessed to be able to use technology to meet, but occasionally it has its issues.
Yes, sir. I asked the coach to call the 1-800 number. I'm not sure if he's on the line yet.
Right. Well, whenever he's available, we'd love to hear from him.
Mr. Chairman, can I make a comment while we're waiting?
Of course.
This is Pat Malanfi down in Pioneers. I just want to thank the Highway Patrol, the work that they did for the U.S. Open. Everything went down very well down in Pioneers. The USGA was ecstatic as to how the event went. And just want to thank the Colonel and the Highway Patrol for the significant resources they sent to Pioneers for that week. Thank you.
Thank you for that comment, Pat. I also observed that as well as many other events that we have across the state, from the state fair to all the football games and the basketball games at universities. The patrol is always there to make sure everyone gets in and out safely, and we appreciate that, Colonel.
Yes, sir, and I appreciate his kind words, and I don't want to, forget, I'm very proud of the work that the patrol did down in that area. You know, we've helped them frequently with those opens, and we know how important that is. And one of the things about that event is we're managing about a 10-mile zone, trying to make all that stuff flow very efficiently. And I mean, we had some key partners from DOT help us with that as well, and I don't want to leave them out. But we know that experience of going to an event of that nature, if they go out there and they get stuck in traffic or they can't get out of that area, that diminishes that for those folks. And we clearly understood that. And not only that, but, anybody who wants to go to an event of that nature, if they have to drive through 100-plus black and silver state trooper vehicles, they're going to think about doing anything crazy before they get there. And that has that deterrent effect as well. But we're grateful for there again, a great partnership with DOT again. And but thank you for the kind words, and I'm very proud of the patrol as well. So, and you should be proud of your team on the defensive side. But thank you.
Thank you, Colonel. We value your partnership. How are we doing with Ms. Wallen connecting via phone?
Yeah, we're still not able to connect with her. Shelly's tried to call her, and I just checked in again, and she has not called back to get her on. So,
sure. I can see she's feverishly working.
Yeah.
Well, Ms. Wallen, if it's okay, we may move to the next one and have those speakers, and then we'll come back from you when we get you connected. Thank you. All right. The next one is the Trooper Brandon C. Peterson Bridge. We have Ella Peterson Autry, who is Trooper Brandon's wife, and then Captain Randy Deaton, Lieutenant Joshua Dowdle, First Sergeant Cody Smith, and Don Stamey, and Colonel Johnson again with the Highway Patrol. So, Miss Autry, if you are on and would like to say a few words, we would love to hear from you. Shelley, Okay. All right. Well, Colonel or anyone else from the patrol, does anyone like to say a few words about Trooper Peterson's?
Yes, sir. Chairman Fox, again, I do want to thank the board for helping us with Trooper Peterson's bridge naming. I could tell you that he was an outstanding member of the Highway Patrol. I actually knew Brandon, and he took his work as a trooper very seriously. And this was an absolutely unbelievable loss to us, that what happened with Brandon. And we were all stunned by that. And he was definitely a model trooper for our agency. And I mean, a great family man. He was very well respected in that area. And I know his family is on here, and I know how very supportive they were of him and what his career on the patrol and since this incident occurred. But again, I want to thank the board for helping us get this done, get this across the line. And I look forward to the day that we get to go out and celebrate with the family. We actually put that sign up. So I give it back to you, and I just thank the board and everybody who behind the scenes worked on this to get this done. So thank you.
Thank you, Colonel.
Okay, I think I may be on.
All right. Can you hear me? I see Captain Deaton is on as well. Did you want to add anything?
Yeah. If everybody can hear me, I would like to add something on Trooper Peterson. Actually, it's a personal thing with me because Trooper Peterson, I've done his background. I was his sergeant, his first sergeant when this happened. And he was a true leader in the community and with the Highway Patrol. And we just want to say thank you for doing this. It is a true pleasure to take part in naming something for Brandon, because Brandon was one of those guys that led in his community and the Highway Patrol. And well, again, I just appreciate it. Just wanted to jump on the coattails of the colonel and say a few things, because Brandon really meant a lot to a lot of us. And thank y'all.
Thank you, Captain. Is there anyone else from the family that is on, Maria?
No.
Okay.
Ms. Wallen, I think, can communicate with us now.
Great. Well, let's go back to Ms. Wallen. It looks like
she was.
Looks like she's on the phone. Is it not with you?
Yes.
All right.
I just heard her a little bit ago. We lost her again. Miss Wallen, I believe you're muted still on your end. Check your phone. Yeah, she was. So sorry, we still can't hear you.
What a calling yet? Okay, all right. Keep me informed, and we'll continue to work with Ms. Wallen and the coach, and whenever they can join us, we'll take them. In the meantime, let's we'll move on through the rest of our business, and hopefully we'll get connected with them very soon. Our next action item, or information item, is the Innovative Technology and Product Awareness report. That's been provided to you on the board's website, and I want to thank our staff at the Materials and Test Unit for putting this together each month. Our next agenda item is remarks from Secretary Hopkins, so I would invite Joey to share with us what's been going on in the last month.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You hear me okay?
Yes.
Good morning, everyone. We're glad you could join us today virtually. June was a very busy month, so I'll get right into it, starting with a brief legislative update. As most of you know, the legislature overturned Governor Cooper's veto of our agency bill. That's House Bill 198. We understand the governor's concerns with the provision in that bill that allows additional cutting around billboards. Just as a reminder, that was not put in that bill by us, but by others. However, the bill does include other items that are important to us, and we're glad to see that they passed. Just as a few examples, there's a provision in there authorizing us to establish a pilot program to award contracts for up to 5 transportation projects using the progressive design build delivery method. There's also a provision allowing us to increase our CMGC delivery method pilot from 5 to 10 projects. We've also been able to extend the Build Bond Act through 2031 and lift the cash cap that enables us to issue bonds. And our financial staff has started working on a potential bond release for later this year. In addition to that bill, House Bill 199 and Senate Bill 607 both passed and are now law. House Bill 199 is mainly DMV items, and there's a provision in there that authorizes us to issue mobile driver's license. It also includes a provision for us to develop a work zone safety course and work with the Department of Public Instruction to include it in the driver training curriculum. We've talked about this frequently, but work zones are an unsafe area, not just for motors, but also for the workers in there. And that's something that we've been working with AGC and CAPA on something like this, and so we're happy to see this pass. Senate Bill 607 is a regulatory reform bill, and there are a few provisions in there related to DOT. One of them, we now have clarification that we do have authorization to use different contract options to utilize the federal NEVI funds. Those are the funds that we're using to install charging infrastructure on our alternative fuel corridors. And it also requires DIT in consultation with DMV to evaluate our efforts to modernize our IT systems. So moving over to the U.S. Open, and I'd like to start by thanking Board Member Malanfi and also Colonel Johnson for thanking everybody there. I also want to congratulate and thank our Division 8 staff, of course, the Highway Patrol, our rail team, and all our staff and partners who helped make the U.S. Open a success.
Colonel Johnson for thanking everybody there.
One of the highlights of the U.S. Open was the Open Express, which was daily train service between Raleigh Union Station and the Pinehurst Clubhouse, carrying nearly 2,500 passengers directly to the course. This train sold out in a matter of days, and I think that helps demonstrate the popularity of passenger rail in North Carolina and also shows the need for improved and expanded train service to locations not already served by NC by train. This was a true team effort with so many partners, including the Federal Railroad Administration, Amtrak, the Aberdeen, Carolina, and Western Railway, our private rail partners, and of course, the USGA. We'd like to thank everybody involved for their help in bringing this train, the first ever of its kind, to Pinehurst. And speaking of trains, last week, Secretary Buttigieg visited the state to check out several projects. On Monday, he joined us at a groundbreaking for the Durant Road grade separation. This is the first construction project on the S-Line Raleigh to Wake Forest project that we received the $1.09 billion grant to help fund. Later that same day, he joined us to check out the Blue Ridge Road grade separation project near the fairgrounds in West Raleigh. This project is funded in part by a Tiger grant that we received a few years ago. Then on Tuesday, Secretary Buttigieg was in the Triad and joined Chairman Fox and Pat Ivey, among others, to check out the Winston-Salem Northern Beltway project and the city's Salem Parkway multi-use path project before heading back, making stops at A&T's research facility and test track in Greensboro, and also in Durham for their Holloway Street project, which received a grant recently, a RAISE grant. We're always glad to host USDOT leadership and are thankful for their support making these projects happen. On June 25th, we had a groundbreaking at GTP for the Fleet Readiness Center East, or FRCE, project. This U.S. Navy facility will be used to maintain and repair C-130s and also some of the helicopters they fly, and will create more than 400 new jobs and generate over $400 million in new investment for the region. Construction on this facility is scheduled to be complete by September 2026. The Operation Firecracker Booze It and Lose It campaign began in late June and concluded this past Sunday. The initiative uses public outreach and stepped up law enforcement to discourage drunk driving. Statewide, law enforcement had increased patrols and checkpoints to promote safety and remove impaired drivers from the road. Nearly 2,000 checkpoints and patrols took place during the week-long campaign. This resulted in over 36,000, let me say that again, 36,000 total traffic and criminal violations. We want to thank our law enforcement officials, including the State Highway Patrol, for their diligent work over the holiday weekend and beyond. And we want to encourage drivers to plan ahead as we work towards a safer environment for everyone. You know, the campaign has ended, but the message does not end here. Just want to remind everybody to obey the laws of the road, buckle up, focus on the road while driving, don't speed, and never drink and drive. On the planning and programming front, we're currently in the process of identifying projects for the next 10-year capital plan. I know all of our board members are familiar with this. The next step covers the years 2026 through 2035. And we had a we have a public comment period that's ongoing. It started June 17th, and we're asking folks to share their transportation interest through this month, July 17th. We've had drop-in sessions in most of the transportation divisions already, but we do have a few divisions that have yet to hold their in-person meetings. We've also got an online survey people can take during this comment period, and the meeting schedule, locations, and the survey link can be found at ncdot.gov. We do expect the regional impact funded projects list to be released in late September, and a comment period for the division needs phase will follow, and the draft STEP is expected to be released in early 2025. Beginning last week, several DMV fees increased. Under state law, fees for approximately 90 license and registration related services rose by an average of just over 19%. And as an example, regular driver's license fees has increased by $1 per year. That translates to an additional $5 for a 5-year license or $8 for an 8-year license. Customers will also notice a new processing fee when using credit or debit cards for DMV transactions. And this is also in person, online, and at the self-service kiosk. And as a reminder, 16 of our driver's license offices across the state are now open to walk-ins on Saturdays from 8 to noon. These Saturday hours were planned to be offered through August 24th. And already we've served more than 7,000 customers on these Saturdays. And that means these 7,000 customers aren't on our at our driver's license offices during the week, taking other times that are now available to other members of the public. To learn more about these fee changes and locations that are open on Saturdays, you can visit myncdmv.gov. Thousands of people got their first look at the southern expansion of NC 540 in Wake County on June 22nd as we hosted 540 Fest, a celebration of the Phase 1 extension of the Triangle Expressway. The event included run and bike races near the US 401 interchange in southern Wake County, and you can find photos from the event on our NCDOT Flickr account. Our goal is to have this section of 540, this is between the Holly Springs or NC 55 bypass and I-40 near the Wake Johnston County line. Our goal is to have it open in late August. And to learn more about the project, you can visit our website and search Complete 540. We want to congratulate maintenance staff from each of our transportation divisions who came together for the Equipment Operators Safety Training Conference, or as we all know it, the State Rodeo, on June 19th. Staff from across the state competed in 8 different categories, showcasing their skills while promoting safety and fostering team spirit. I want to congratulate Division 13, Tim Anderson, and Billy for bringing home this year's state championship. Congratulations to you guys. We will recognize the individual winners from each category at a future board meeting, and these winners will go on to compete in the Southeastern Rodeo, which we're hosting here in North Carolina in September. Thanks to Robin Barfield and his team, all the division staff and other partners to help put this event on. It really takes a lot of people to do something like this. And I'm grateful for Robin and everybody that did that. It was a great event. I do want to remind everyone of some upcoming dates for some of our educational and training programs. For our technical training series, we've got events tomorrow in Fayetteville and July 25th in Greensboro, covering the topic of utility installation and adjustments. This pilot program offers various courses to small highway construction contractors interested in working on DOT projects. We've also got an upcoming educational session on pre-qualification that's scheduled for next week, July 18th in Durham. This is for firms interested in working on our construction projects. They're required to become pre-qualified, and these sessions are really helped at aiming them to do business with us. Interested firms can find more information about this and others on tap for later this year by searching our Connect site for pre-qualification campaign. In closing, we have a feel-good to share with you on North Carolinian Tamika Jenkins. Tamika is reminded of her birthplace every time she drives across the Cape Fear Memorial Bridge, and we have this video to show you why.
My mom waited too long to go to Wilmington, what we call going to Tampa. And when she finally did get in the car to take me to the hospital, she ended up having me on the bridge going into Wilmington. Every time we cross the bridge, it's just an exciting thing because I think,
Jeremy, I'm not getting any audio.
I was born on the bridge.
I'm not either, Mr. Chairman. I can hear it in the boardroom, but I can't hear it going through the system.
Is the person who's presenting that maybe on mute? I could.
My mom waited too long to go to Wilmington.
They're working on it.
Perfect.
Yes. Call going to Tampa.
Can you hear it now?
When she finally did get in the car.
Yeah, Stacy is still not working.
It looks like Stacy's muted, at least what it's showing on my screen.
Yeah, maybe that's what it is. We'll see.
My mom waited too long to go to Wilmington.
Now, you're
all going to Tampa. And when she finally did get in the car to take me to the hospital, she ended up having me on the bridge going into Wilmington. Every time we cross the bridge, it's just an exciting thing because I think, oh my goodness, I was born on this bridge and I go into town at least once a week. So it's really nice to think that my mom really delivered me herself. I had always paid attention to when they were going to do work on the bridge because I figured all you could do is get a no. So I just thought, I'm just going to ask and tell them how I was born on the bridge. And just maybe I could just get a little tiny piece of little rock. So I was so excited. I've been so excited.
That's awesome, Joni.
Yeah, that's a neat story. I want to thank the communications office for highlighting this unique story and also the Division 3 staff for the keepsake she received during the recent bridge rehab project. Mr. Chairman, that's all the remarks I have today. I'm happy to take any questions if there are any.
Are there any questions for Secretary Hopkins? Well, I will say one thing. I know Colonel Johnson had to drop off. He had another situation he had to deal with, but I know Pat's son is in law enforcement, and I have a son in law enforcement with the patrol. And of all of the potential terrifying things that they can encounter every day, I think one of my son's worst nightmares is the thought of having to deliver a baby on the side of the road. So that really hit home. He thought that was going to happen one day, but the EMS got there just in time. So that's a very touching and sweet story, and I'm glad we were able to give her a memento of that momentous occasion. All right, so have we had any success in getting Ms. Wallen audio?
She is on the phone call. If you would try and unmute her, she's trying to talk on the phone.
Can you hear me now?
Yes,
we can. Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Wow.
Thank you for
your patience. Thank you so much for your patience.
Well, thank you.
I knew what I was going to say before all this, but now it's like, ooh. Anyway, good morning, Mr. Chairman and board members. It is an honor to speak before you. I am, as Ms. Heath said, Johnny's younger sister, and I'm here representing Johnny's siblings and their families. And we are just so appreciative of the recognition for Johnny, and we wish to sincerely thank Captain Deaton, Lieutenant Dowell, Sergeant Smith, Ms. Stamey, Ms. Heath, the North Carolina Highway Patrol, the North Carolina Department of Transportation, and all of you for the time and energy that you've expended to bring this resolution to a vote this morning. Johnny's short life was dedicated to service and sacrifice. Right out of high school, he joined the military and served our country as an MP in the United States Air Force. He then returned to his home state of North Carolina and served Avery County and its citizens as a member of the North Carolina Highway Patrol. April the 1st, 2024, marked 58 years that Johnny has been gone. and to know that he was not forgotten by the Highway Patrol or the people of Avery County that he served is truly humbling to his family. And again, we sincerely thank you so much for this opportunity and the recognition afforded to our brother, Highway Patrolman John William Waller. Thank you so much. God bless you.
Thank you,
Ms. Waller. Sorry for all the technical challenges.
No problem at all. Thank you for your patience with our technical problems. Sorry for your loss and your family sacrifice, but know that it is appreciated and it gives us it's our honor to be able to help remember your brother.
Thank you so much. And I certainly
want to give full credit to Colonel Johnson and his entire staff and our staff, Shelley. We've worked really hard once Colonel Johnson became aware that there were a number of troopers across the state who had not been honored. He and I had a conversation with Secretary Hopkins, and we decided we're going to get this thing done. And so this is one of many well-deserved honors. And like I said, this is one of the things that we feel it's the least we can do. And we appreciate your willingness to hang in there with us during our technology and look forward to seeing you at the formal dedication. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Thank you. I also
Chairman,
see
it looks
we,
like Coach Williams.
Coach Williams. Good morning, Coach. Again, my apologies for our technical difficulties, but we're glad you're here.
Oh, guys, this has been, I guess this is the greatest day of my life. And I really appreciate each and every one of you all and all those who saw this vision. And I still say Wake County is the greatest county in the world to live in. I understand now why I didn't go to the University of Southern Cal, to the University of Cincinnati, to the University of South Carolina when I was job offers. But I love this county. I love the people in the county. And definitely the DOT has always been in my corner. And you always represented me and St. Augustine at the time I was there in a very fashionable way. And I thank you. I love you guys. And anytime that I can do anything or be any assistant for this county, please don't hesitate to let me know, because there are so many young kids in here I'm still working with, and I'm still trying to help follow their dreams in the world of track and field. This is what I do, and this is what I know. And I thank each and every one of you all from the bottom of my heart for making this a dream that come true. And I can't wait to see my buddy Mike Suseski say, oh, boy. he and I are very good friends, and I can't wait to see him. And I'm going to ask him out for lunch and say, boy, what a world that we live in, a beautiful world. And thanks each and every one of you on the committee. And I'm here for you guys just like you were here for me. And I thank you, and I thank the community of Southeast Raleigh for always being there for me and for my student athlete. And as we said, we graduate kids from all over the world, and especially the United States of America. So we've had, on the United States American team, we had 4 gold medals. And so we're proud of that. And I think I represented this country to the utmost, and I will always continue to represent the United States of America. And I'm on my way to Paris at the end of the month, and I will be there to support the United States of America track and field team.
Thank you, Coach, and thank you for not only your service to our country and our state and your hometown there of Raleigh, but also for what you do for those individual kids each and every day. And it's truly our honor to be able to recognize your life's work, which is amazing. And from what you're telling me, you're not anywhere close to being done. So we appreciate that.
Not done until I put the foot in the box. I'm a working.
Well, thank you.
God, give me the will in the strip.
And you and Coach K now both have roads, and so maybe y'all can ride together and compare and see who's got the better road.
We are going to do that. I'm going to tell him as soon as he get back from Vegas. I know he's in Vegas with the national team because they need his input at all times. And when he get back, I'm going to make that call. Thank you all so very much from the bottom of my heart. I love each and every one of y'all. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Coach, and thank you for your patience with us with our technology. And I look forward to your dedication. Maybe you'll get Coach K to come.
Oh, that would be great. That would definitely be a lot. Okay, thank you.
Great. Thank you so much. All right. Our next item is delegated authority. I would note that items C, D, H, and L are delegated to the secretary and require no formal action by the board. And for the record, on item C, all projects were awarded by the secretary to the low bidder. So the action items are the consideration of the projects. Are there any recusals that any board members need to? I see Tony waving his hand. Go ahead, Tony.
As usual, I have a handful, and I've turned in my form and just will incorporate that by reference here. I think I've got three or four conflicts that I'm going to recuse from. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Thank you, Tony. Anyone else that has conflicts? I can't see everyone on the screen, so if you do, just speak up. All right. Hearing none. If you would please, as Tony indicated, provide your conflict form if you have any. And
Chairman, is that you? Yes, sir. Sorry about that. Apologies. Yeah, due to potential conflicts, would like to refer to my form for potential conflict.
Right. Thank you, Landon. Anyone else? All right. Are there any questions or items that need to be discussed on the proposed action list? If not, I would look for a motion to approve.
Motion to approve, Mr. Chairman.
Good. All right, Chairman. Motion by Andy, second by Stephen. Any discussion? All right, we'll do a roll call. I vote yes. Andy Perkins?
Yes. Yes.
Alan Moran?
Alan Moran?
Yes.
Mary Jo Alcoke?
Yes.
Landon Zimmer?
Yes.
Melvin Mitchell?
Yes.
Leo Daughtry?
Yes.
Valerie Jordan?
Yes.
Brady Hunt? I know Grady's on and having audio problems. He told me to record him as a yes for this vote, if you would, Aria, for the minutes. Lisa Mathis?
Yes.
Pat Malamphy?
Yes.
Stephen Rosenborough? I think you were on mute, Stephen. I assume that's a yes. Give me a thumbs up. There you go. Stephen's a yes. Tony Lathrop?
Yes.
Megan Phillips?
Yes.
Brad Lale?
Yes.
Kathy Harrington? Billy Clark? I know Billy was with us. You may be on mute, Billy. All right, we'll move on to Dirk Cody?
Yes.
And Chuck McGrady?
Yes.
All right, that passes unanimously. The other business, I know, Tony, you wanted to make a comment.
Yep, just a real quick finance comment, Mr. Chairman. Just to note for our stakeholders as well as our board members here and all of our partners that are on and pay attention to these things. And our Fast Five and our financial snapshot has been posted online. And, and I think it's important just to mention that since we are fiduciaries and the cash position is good. The expenses and revenue are all good, and open commitments are also good. And I'll just leave the details to that, you know, for folks that want to look at that form posted online. It's very easy to do, just to find the link. Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Right. Thank you, Tony. And thank you and Chuck, who were the chairman and vice chairman of our finance committee. As I'm sure all of you know, they're in lots of meetings beyond this meeting to make sure that we're complying with everything we need to at all times. So I appreciate you, both of y'all's service in those leadership role on that committee. Our upcoming meetings will be back in the highway building for our August meeting. It is a day earlier. Everybody note that on your calendar. It's going to be Tuesday, August 6th and Wednesday, August 7th. On the morning of August 6th, we're actually scheduled to tour the license plate plant at the Women's Correctional Facility. That's where we make all the license plates. I think you're going to enjoy that tour. It would be very informative. Everyone needs to be at the highway building by 8:45 a.m. ready to board the bus, which will be leaving promptly at 9, and we're scheduled to be back at the highway building by 11:30 in time for everyone to take a break for lunch. I will note that Council of State, which is all of the statewide elected officials, will be meeting in our boardroom at 9 a.m. that morning, so just be cognizant of that. If you're thinking about strolling in the boardroom and putting a bunch of stuff down there, there will be a meeting going on, so be aware of that. The committee meetings will begin at 1 o'clock, and that's road naming, internal audit, and finance, and that'll be followed by our work session, and that'll conclude the first day of our meeting on Tuesday. On Wednesday, we'll have our committee meetings in the morning, DMV, EDIR, highways, and multimodal. We'll take a break for lunch, and then we'll conclude with the official board meeting, which will start at 1:15 on that Wednesday. So it's a little bit different than our normal schedule, but the governance staff has done a good job of making sure we can get everything in. We felt it important since we have been traveling so much, and we've had two virtual meetings in May and July that we did give the committees a chance to meet. So that's why we wanted to make sure we got everything in there. Aurea will be sending out the information regarding what the credentials you need and what you can take and not take into the Women's Correctional Facility. It might not shock you that that's a very restrictive list. So make sure you try to comply with that if you plan to attend that with us. In August, we'll also be approving the DMS biennial budget for state fiscal years 2024, 2025, and 2026. Aurea will be sending everyone the budget report to review following the meeting, and Jamie Lancaster, our environmental analysis unit head, will be at the meeting to answer any questions you may have, and also feel free to contact Jamie in the meantime if you have any questions. Looking forward to September. We're traveling again. And it's scheduled for September 3rd through 5th. We're going to be going to Division 9 and primarily in the Winston-Salem area. Andy and Pat have done a great job putting a great agenda together for us along with the governance team. And so if you've not already completed the survey about whether you plan to attend in lodging, please do that as soon as you can so we can make sure everyone has a room. And Aria will be sending out the preliminary itinerary for you next week. Updates in governance. We have two new temporary employees that have joined the team. Erica Roebuck is serving as an administrative specialist for the governor's office, and Crystal Flowers will be serving as our interim board secretary while Marilyn is out on maternity leave, which is effective August 1st. And Marilyn, congratulations in advance. I hope everything goes well. And I'm sure Aria will let us know. So thank you for your service. Mr. Secretary, anything you want to add? Or?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. I have two other quick items. I appreciate the opportunity.
First of all, based on the language that we've got with the NC Build Bond, staff is working on a spend plan update. And so that'll go through the Financial Planning Committee and Financial Committee before the August board meeting. But we may ask the board to go ahead and approve that spend plan amendment with that at the August meeting, so we can keep moving forward to having a sale before the end of the year. If you remember, the language in that law only allows us to sell up to $300 million in bonds annually. So we'd like to go ahead and get a bond sale in this year, so then we'll have the opportunity to do one next year if we need to. So we'll have all that together by August. It'll go through the committee, and Tony and his folks will review it, and hopefully they'll have a recommendation to the board in August. So I did want to mention that. If there's any questions or concerns, please let us know about that. We will not have an amendment for the budget since we don't have a new budget. So the spend plan that was developed based on the second year of the biennium, that part of the spend plan is still good. So the only change at this time will be the $300 million in potential bond sales. The other thing I have, I understand this may be Chad Kimes' last board meeting. So I didn't want to let this opportunity go by without thanking Chad for his service, for everything he's done for the state of North Carolina, for NCDOT, but most especially Division III. Chad's done a super job down there. He's one of our leaders in developing employees to move into their roles. And I'm so thankful for everything that he's done for DOT. Wish him well in his retirement. And Chad and I have a little bit of a connection. My very first job at DOT in Division 7, I worked for Chad's dad, Doug. So he was my first supervisor. I'm not going to tell you how many years ago that is, but I have outlasted Doug and now Chad. So, Chad, congratulations to you, and wish you the best in your next endeavor.
I see Landon popped up. I suspect you'd like to add something to that. Is that right, Landon?
Yes, I mean, Chad's been going on the whirlwind tour of MPOs and RPOs, picking up awards and hardware in the southeast of North Carolina. I guess they really will miss him after all. So, you know, can't say enough about Chad, how much we're going to miss him. He's got a great bench, so, you know, look forward to next division engineer there, but definitely going to miss Chad, and hopefully he won't be too far away.
Well, and I'll add to that as well. I've had the chance to work with Chad on a number of projects, and he's always been incredibly knowledgeable, B, incredibly professional, and he always brings a problem solving attitude to anything. So that's exactly what we need at all levels in the department. So Chad, you will be missed, but we wish you well, and don't be a stranger.
Thank you, everyone.
Oh. Great. Thanks, Chad. I'm glad you were able to chime in.
No, I just want to tell you, I love all y'all. Appreciate everything y'all do, everything y'all have done for me. Thank you a lot.
Thank you. And good luck in whatever you choose to do next. So, any other items for discussion from board members? Well, I want to thank you all again for your patience with the technology. And also, as you might can imagine, I'll give you a brief update. You know, we're working really hard on honoring these highway patrol troopers and patrolmen who made the ultimate sacrifice in the line of duty. Just so you know, the road, bridge, and ferry naming committee met this morning, and we approved some 14. So your board agendas going forward, we're going to be stacking them in, but it's important to the families and to the patrol. And so I appreciate your patience in working through that. And I know that a number of you there, I think there were four or five divisions that were represented in those road namings this morning. So a number of you will get an opportunity to participate in that. All right. Is there, seeing no other items for discussion, is there a motion to adjourn? All right, great. So motion by Tony. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Leo. I will vote yes. Andy Perkins?
Yes.
Alan Moran?
Yes.
Mary Jo Alcock?
Yes.
Landon Zimmer?
Yes.
Melvin Mitchell?
Yes.
Leo Daughtry?
Yes.
Valerie Jordan?
Yes.
Grady Hunt? We'll record Grady as a yes on that. Lisa Mathis?
Yes.
Pat Malamphy?
Yes.
Steven Rosenborough? I see him saying yes, although I can't hear him, but give him the thumbs up. There you go. Tony Lathrop?
Yes.
Megan Phillips?
Yes.
Brad Lael?
Yes.
Kathy Harrington? Billy Clark? Dirk Cody?
Yes, sir.
And Chuck McGrady?
Yes.
All right, that passes unanimously. Thank you all for your service and your time this morning, and I hope you have the rest of a great July, and I will look forward to seeing you in August. Take care, everyone.
There you have it, what officials said today at the North Carolina Department of Transportation meeting. So, again, it's a little cumbersome to try to find some of these meetings. It's really interesting to me how or why they choose some a platform such as Vimeo to host it. But nevertheless, it is nice to have it be have a virtual option to not only see what officials are saying, but as a journalist to cover this remotely as well. So you did hear that they passed several resolutions to name bridges after fallen state troopers, and there's more information on NCDOT.gov on the board meetings website about that. So if this was helpful to you, if you appreciated my work, I really appreciate your support in a paid subscription to Cops in Congress by Annie Dance, annydance.substack.com. Thanks for watching. See you next time.